Wow. Hi, ladies.
We had no idea that there were all of you out
here. This is amazing.
Jessica, I'm so glad to be able to ask you questions because you have acquired so many titles all at the same time. Actor, yeah. Artist, philanthropist. And you have done something that I think a lot of people here want to do, which is to take a life experience and turn it into a business. How did that happen?
Wow. Well, to give you guys a little bit of context, about 8 years ago, I had my first daughter. And when I was pregnant with my first daughter, I actually had an allergic reaction to a laundry detergent that my mom recommended that I use that was supposedly the best one to use for babies. I immediately called my mom and I was like, why did you recommend this laundry detergent? I'm allergic to it. I have hives on my hands. I'm sneezing. My eyes are watering. What's going on? And my mom said, you asked me for my advice and I gave it to you. If you don't want it, don't take it. But you're being really hormonal. And I'm like, I'm pregnant. And she goes, well, call me back when you've calmed down. So I was like, all right, I'm gonna Google this. I'm gonna figure out what the heck is in this thing that made me have this allergic reaction. And what I found out is there are lots of untested, potentially harmful chemicals in everything in and around my home, including this laundry detergent, household cleaners, personal care products like shampoos, body washes, lotions, makeup, even the paint in the mattress that was in my home could be potentially harmful. So I freaked out and I was like, well, what do I buy? And I went and I tried to shop at all the natural grocery store chains. I went and bought stuff overseas, and it was very challenging to try and find one company that I could trust that was transparent about what was inside and provided safe and healthy products. I also, you know, the convenience factor of getting it delivered straight to my door as a new mom was tremendous. And then also affordability. To me, it didn't seem fair that safer and healthier products had to be so outside of most people's price point. And so making the prices affordable and accessible was very important. So that's the business that I created. It's called The Honest Company. And it really came out of a true need and desire to give people access to safe and effective products, and also a community where you can get valuable and useful information and you can have real strong takeaways. The thing that I had to get over as a human person was my own insecurities about, you know, I don't have a typical business trajectory. I didn't go to business school. I had to know what I was good at, and I had to surround myself with people that were experts and in fields that I wasn't.
So how did you get from an idea, a business idea, to the cover of Forbes magazine? I mean, in between there, it's a question of capital. Where did that come from?
Yeah, the capital was an issue. I actually spent my own money for about 3.5 years as I was refining how to go into enter the marketplace. My original business plan was 100 pages long and included paint and air filters and water filters and makeup and every product really that's in and around your home, down to mattresses. And I honed that down to a pretty streamlined amount of products. So household cleaners, basic personal care products, and diapers and wipes. So everything that would touch your new little person that you brought into the world and you on a day-to-day basis. And so that's, you know, I took that 100-page deck down to a 20-page deck. I pitched it to my business partner. He turned me down. And then I went back 18 months later with the 20-page deck. And at that point, he had a kid of his own. and another one on the way, and he saw that his wife had changed her shopping habits. She started caring about, you know, buying organic food and having safer and healthier products in her home to clean with and whatnot. And I think he had that light bulb that he wanted to have a safe and healthy environment for his own child. So he came on as my business partner. And because he was an entrepreneur and he had done this before, when we walked in to raise capital, it was much easier. If I would have walked in on my own, I wouldn't have had the success that I had at all. Mm-hmm. It really was finding the right partners that could execute on the idea. And it's a marriage. I mean, the people that you partner with in business, you're like, you don't even get to date. I mean, you're just jumping right into marriage.
Okay, true. Well, that brings us to the question of the family and what family produced you, right? Because you came from California, your dad was in the military, the generation before you were Mexican immigrants.
Yeah.
You called yourself a feminist at five. You have to love this woman, right? At five years old, she called herself a feminist.
I believed in equality at five. It was actually even earlier than that probably, but I think I was in line at Disneyland, and for some reason, it's on camera that I said to the camera, I am an independent woman, I'm a feminist, and I don't need a man for nothing. And that's what I said at 5 years old.
Well, I think you hear kids say that all the time, you know, it's not fair, you are not the boss of me. Okay, this is the basis of all social justice movements right there.
Right.
Right. But how do you think your family contributed to your success?
I think more than anything, they did it through through example. My grandmother, she actually had five kids. She supported the family while she had five kids and put my grandfather through school, up to graduate school, all on her back. She ran a restaurant, she cooked the food, she served the tables, and she did all of the accounting. And then after he graduated, he got a good job, then she retired at 35. But up until that point, she worked to the bone, man. And then my mother as well, just her resilience. She always worked three jobs minimum growing up to provide for the family. Both my parents worked day and night, and they were both equal parts of the family unit. You know, my dad was gonna wash the dishes if my mom cooked the food, and then while my dad was washing the dishes, my mom was putting us to bed. Like, it really was a two-hander. So I did actually grow up in an environment where equality was very present.
So you have to see it to be it. I think that
so.
Helps a lot.
That certainly made an imprint on me, for sure.
But so now, what about acting? I mean, that's the first A in your biography. When did that come into your life?
Oh, Lord. Gosh, I think I was always, it's in the blood. There's certainly performers in my family, lots of artists, mostly theater and musicians, but I think it was just a place for me to express myself. I grew up in a very conservative family, and it was a place where I felt liberated, and I felt like I can, you know, weirdly, in being someone else, I could figure out who I am and find a voice. And also, I felt that there was a lack of women of color that were represented as heroines in pop culture in general. And I felt like, you know, there are a lot of people that look like me out there in the world, and we just weren't being represented. And so I think the reason why I was successful was I was relatable to a lot of people.
So were you doing that as a little girl? Were you doing
make-believe? When I was 12, when I was actually sick a lot, and I was in the hospital from age 5 to about 11. I had three pretty bad, you know, surgeries, pretty big surgeries, and I was in and out of the hospital a couple times a month for complications with asthma and allergies. So I think just being alone a lot as a kid and, you know, pretending to be someone else. And really, I wanted to be a superhero, so it's weird that I became one. Thank you, James Cameron. Thank you, Fox. They allowed me to actually be a superhero.
No, well, that's it is. You have to see it to be it. I mean, yeah. That is, you know, yet another example of that. But then on top of everything else, in launching this acting, launching a successful company and so on, you wrote a New York Times best-selling book, which those of us who are writers thinking, wait a minute, she does all this other stuff and then she's also writing a best-selling book.
By the way, I don't know if I ever want to do that again. It was so hard.
Well, it's
that was probably the most agonizing.
It's well, good. I'm glad at least us writers want you to
know
it's agonizing, right?
Girl, writing a book is no joke.
But it's called The Honest Life.
Yes, yes.
And so, you know, what made you do that?
That was because I just felt like there was so much information out there. And certainly if you were in academia, you were used to reading about toxic chemicals and certain chemicals that are linked to illnesses. But for regular people, especially new moms who are overtired, overworked, and hormonal, trying to figure out what is what, it's too much information. And it was hard to disseminate that information and to distill it down to something that you could actually apply to your life. And so I just wanted a book that was just a useful guide to break down certain chemicals and certain things in your environment that you may want to avoid because they could have a potentially harmful effect on your health. Now, this came out of so much research has said that the rise of cancers, the rise of learning disabilities, obesity, all of these things, asthma, allergies, all of these have to do with toxic triggers in our environment. And it's everyday stuff that we aren't even aware of. And so as much as we can control what goes in our home and what goes in our body to live a healthier life, I think people want to. We just need access to that information. So that's
right.
Really what the book
I'm
is.
I'm sold. I'm going out to buy your book, The Honest Life.
I'll give you one.
Okay, but here's
my poor husband, literally until like 3 a.m, every sentence I was like, are you sure that this is the way this should be said? He's like, just go to sleep, seriously.
Okay, there's another mystery I would like to clear up, which is that in all of this process, a lot of people said no to you.
Oh, yeah.
And you actually have said that you needed people to say no. What did you mean?
Gosh, in a weird way, when people say no or would doubt me, it fueled me to prove them wrong. I don't know, I just felt like in life, certainly as an actress, you literally live off of rejection, and that's just part of the game, but in business as well, the more people that didn't believe in me, the more I was determined to find the truth and to make it happen. What about you? The word no? When was the last time someone told you no, and when was the last time you said no to someone?
I have a really hard time saying no when somebody asks me to do something. You know,
okay.
So I have a cartoon on my bulletin board that says, it's a man saying to another man on the phone, what about never? Is never good for you? I try to remember this. And I'm afraid that when somebody says no or doesn't agree, I have an awful impulse to say, you don't agree? Let me explain it to you again.
Let's figure out another way.
Yeah,
love that.
Right.
That's amazing. Okay, I'd like to shift gears now and talk about women in the workplace. A major new leanin.org McKinsey study found that at the rate gender equality is being addressed in corporate America today, it will take more than a century for there to be true gender equity in top leadership positions. Why do you think that is?
Because a lot of people are making a lot of money off the fact that we are either not paid at all for the work that we do in the home, or we are underpaid for the work we do outside of the home. So, you know, it's going to take major rebellion to change that. and major legislation to change that. And there are ways of doing it. For instance, we could have legislation, as some other countries do, that attributes an economic value at replacement level to all of the caregiving work that still mostly women do, though some men do too. But whether done by men or women, you attribute an economic value to it, and then that becomes tax deductible. So it acquires an economic value. And also, when it comes to equal pay, we have to understand that this is not a woman's issue over here in a silo. Actually, equal pay for women of all races would put something like $400 billion more into the economy every year. And it would be the single greatest economic stimulus this country could ever have, way better than paying the banks and the mortgage company. And also, you know, because the poorest children are in female-headed households and need government services, they would need fewer government services. It would take us, it would save tax dollars. I mean, it's a win-win.
Right.
And so we have to get the question of equal pay out of the silo that says it's a woman's issue into the understanding that it is a national economics issue for absolutely every one of us. And also, we have to be fierce about it. You know, we have to find out what the person before us who had the job was paying and demand it. And in New York State, I'm not sure about here, but we had to pass a piece of legislation called the Equal Pay Fair Free Speech Act, I think, so that you couldn't get fired when you told other people the amount of money you're earning. It's the one thing we know, right? We should be able to tell other people, but employers were firing people for saying that.
That's crazy.
So, you know, we need to fight on all of these fronts.
Well, we have a lot of fighting to do. But I think we'll get there, and hopefully we'll get there in less than 100 years, guys. If anything epitomizes American culture today, it is certainly our love of technology. And the U.S. Department of Labor projects that by 2020, there will be 1.4 million computer specialist job openings. Yet this field is where women are greatly underrepresented. I know at my company, it's very challenging to find women in technology. In fact, only 18% of computer science graduates are women. What do you think is going on? And what can we do about that?
Well, there were always women at the invention stage, but once it required capital, the world of technology, then it became, you know, much less likely that you would find women. So I think that you have to see it to be an argument that, you know, you lived in your life is very important with technology. Girls need to see women doing technology. They need to know that a woman invented the computer language, that a woman invented the router on which all of Cisco is based. You know,
That's cool.
Cisco is here, right? Sandy Lerner is her name. We should say her name, okay. We need to see it, and we need to stop thinking that there is such a thing as a math mind. There is not a math mind, like there is not a history mind. It's just that people learn in different ways.
Right, absolutely. We're at The Honest Company. I launched a brand called Honest Beauty, and we actually give a percentage of revenue to code.org and Girls Who Code, which puts coding curriculum in schools across the country. So it's a passion of mine as well. Here's another good one. Do you have any tips for how women can excel in the workplace?
How women can excel in the workplace?
Yes.
Okay, I think the first thing is to, you know, we compare ourselves to the ideal. You know, when we are considering asking for promotions, say, we say, well, you know, I'm not sure I'm good enough, or even when we apply, I'm not sure I'm good enough. The key is to look at Harry or Irving, who is already doing the job. It will completely demystify the whole thing.
Harry, Irving, look out.
but to look at reality rather than the ideal. We do tend to compare ourselves to the ideal, I fear.
Yeah.
And also to have a group of women and men, too, who support you, you know, because we can't do it by ourselves. We're communal creatures. If we're by ourselves, we tend to feel wrong or crazy. you know, we need some companionship. We need a group rooting for us.
Yeah, I agree. I do kind of feel like a lot of people at my company, a lot of women, and myself included, I often try to be the best and only the best. And if I don't achieve that, I feel like I'm not good enough and I'm really hard on myself. But if I look to the side at this guy or that guy, I probably wouldn't be so hard on myself because everyone's just trying to chip away on the...
I think we got the concept of good enough mothers rather than perfect mothers. We need to get the concept of good enough workers too. You know, we need to look at reality. We'll never be perfect. And the comparison to the perfect is part of what is called internalized oppression, you know, inside us.
So you've said the first problem for all of us, men and women, is not to learn, but to unlearn. What does that mean? And what is some of the most important things you've unlearned in your life? Mm.
Well, I think because we've grown up in a culture that stratifies people and puts labels and hierarchies on people, whatever it is that we experienced in our childhoods, we feel is normal or even inevitable. So that's what I mean by unlearning. Mm. We need to recognize that in a deep sense, a really deep sense, this may be too far out what I'm about to say, but anyway, that there is no gender. Gender is made up. I mean, the differences within what is called feminine or among women are greater than the differences between women and men. And the same is certainly true of race. The differences within one group are greater. So, you know, we just need to unlearn the whole idea that people have to be ranked rather than linked. Mm. That we can be linked. And, you know, it is a challenge to unlearn it, because what we experience in our childhoods, we tend to think is normal, inevitable, due to human nature. And, you know, all the examples we find to the contrary, and all the mutual support we find. I mean, you know, we even do this with the media. Whatever the media says, we may come to think of as the norm, even if it's not the norm. And then we compare ourselves to it.
Right.
So we need to unlearn that and look at the uniqueness of each person and the shared humanity of all of us.
That's beautiful. Thank you. So this is a fun one. What woman in history would you like to see as a businesswoman today, and why?
Oh, that's really hard. Businesswoman. Who would have been a businesswoman? You know, I guess the great goddess who was here before God, I mean, she would have made one hell of a businesswoman. and she would have made a great businesswoman, because it was about equal exchange, it was about balance, it wasn't about hoarding. You know, in the old cultures, the leader was the person who shared and who took care of the group, not the person who accumulated. You know, I think actually that's a great idea for business. You know, because once I met a woman who was a very successful venture capitalist. We were on the plane together going to Boston. She was going to speak at Harvard Business School. We discovered that we had no respect for Harvard Business School, either one of us. So they're always fighting the last battle, and then they want more money because they went to Harvard Business. Anyway, so we decided that we should teach a joint course at Harvard Business School called Money is Boring, which it is if you just accumulate it. If you don't do something interesting with it, money is boring. And then we thought we'd have a little subset seminar called How Much is Enough? How much is enough? Because the whole game idea that infinite amounts, I mean, it doesn't make any sense.
That's true.
So the great goddess as a businesswoman, I wouldn't have thought of that before today, but I'll work on it.
I think you need to go on the road with that class. Because I don't think you should just keep it at HBS. I think we all need that class on money is boring unless you do something interesting with it. It was pretty rad. So thank you so much.
No, thank you so much.
It was an honor to be up here on stage
thank
with you.
Thank you. And I think now we get to have other people on stage with us, right?
I think we have more people coming.
Two folks who you already know who are going to come and join us.
Well, everybody having a great time?
Good. All three of you have taken different avenues to making social change happen, from traditional awareness raising and community building in the marketplace. So let's start with a question for all of you. Do you think the rules of social change themselves are changing? And we're going to start with Gloria.
Well, they're certainly changing in form because of the internet, obviously. I'm not sure they're changing in content because usually, I mean, nothing is always true, but usually you need to speak the truth in order to find out what the problem is and that you are not alone in the problem. Mm-hmm. That changes consciousness, raises a sense of possibilities. Then you name the problem, you know, say domestic violence, which used to be called just life. There was not even a word for it. Mm. Then you begin to change legislation, say, and to make this new idea available in the, you know, fundamental rock bottom lives of most people.
Jessica, what do you see about social change itself changing?
I also don't know if the process is that different if you want to make a big impact. I think how you go about it maybe is a little bit different these days because there is so much transparency, and because of the internet, people are cross-communicating, and there's more accountability for action. And I think if you say you're going to do something, people are expecting you to follow through and actually do it. I also think that there's a new business model in place where you can believe in something, and if you find that you are getting blocked by the government to push through what you believe in and what you want, you can create a for-profit business and prove your model. And so I think that's a new and interesting and innovative way to create social change. And people are voting these days with their pocketbooks.
Definitely. And John, what do you see changing?
First of all, if you guys are wondering, this is a pretty typical Thursday for me.
They were totally wondering.
Hanging with Steinem and Alba, yeah, pretty much every week. I would say I agree with a lot of those sentiments that, first of all, the trust in traditional forms of community and leadership, there's been a lot of trust lost. The good news is the tools have evolved so that people can speak up more easily, they can start their own movement more easily, and there's these things like CrowdRise or Kickstart where people can rally around a cause pretty quickly. And I'll leave it at that.
All right, Gloria, you obviously have been inspiring generations of people and women and me for your entire life, essentially. But do you see an interest in social change growing or diminishing? And what do you say to someone who says, look, I just don't feel like I can make a difference. I feel powerless. This is too big.
Well, I get it from other people. We all get it from each other. No single person invents it. But I do think it's growing profoundly. Now on campus, I mean, in a way on campus, the first effort was that social justice movements changed the curriculum so that there's African American studies and women's studies and gay and lesbian studies and Native Americans, which weren't there. They're still not part of the core curriculum, so you know you have to choose them. So we, but it, at least you know that is that began to change, and we see now on campuses that the whole social setting is being challenged, whether it's sexual assault on campus or whether it is just now football players are beginning to rebel. I mean, this is really serious when you know that, right? Because the suppression of information about brain damage from playing, right. And they're joining, you know, the movements like Black Lives Matter. You know, it feels like it is much more organic and much more populist now than it was.
Jessica, you maybe more than a lot of us have used the internet incredibly beautifully and profitably. Can you speak about how that itself has been a force for change, people living their lives on the web all the time?
Yeah, I mean, I think understanding millennials' behaviors, their, you know, the way that they communicate and the way that they consume information and products, and you know, they are digital natives. Mm-hmm. We can't pretend like that's not the future.
That's a wonderful phrase, digital natives.
Yeah, I mean, this is as much part of who they are as living and breathing in the world. And so, I think, you know, tapping into their behaviors, understanding the platforms that they're on, is imperative to any social change.
I read one study that said millennials are on a device of some kind 70 times a day.
Yeah.
Checking emails 50, 60, you know, alone.
Yeah.
John, your company mission is to spread the power of optimism. Some people, though, say that they get inspiration from trying to inspire social change because of a negative thing that's occurred. So that's sort of maybe coming from a different perspective and a different kind of energy. Can you talk about why you find optimism itself such a powerful force for change and not negative approaches to things as a form of change?
I believe that voicing what is wrong is really important, and that bad things happen in the world and we need to acknowledge those, and they're hard and they're real. It's a matter of where you focus most of your energy. Gloria's example earlier about legislature that to help with gender inequality is a great one, where we acknowledge the problem, but she has a specific solution in mind, and that's what excites us. For us, a big focus is helping kids overcome poverty, violence, and illness. We don't spend a lot of time talking that much about the problem. People can understand that that's a very serious problem. We think there are a lot of solutions out there, and we want to focus people's energy on that. And so we view optimism as not a soft philosophy, it's a pragmatic strategy for accomplishing goals and living a fulfilling life.
Yeah, it's really true that we work as human beings on yes, not on no. I mean, and where you put your energy is where your efforts will go. So we all may be hopeaholics, but it's a practical addiction.
What we focus on will grow.
Right.
And it does take some people raising their hand, and it ties into that first question of we've got places to voice our displeasure with things, to say what we're against, but more important is what are you for, what is the solution you're driving toward, and how do we help you make it a reality?
And some of the schools are even starting to have a philosophy of, instead of saying a child can't read or I can't do my algebra, you say I can't do it yet. It's not yet. Mm-hmm. Because that indicates you will. Someday you will be able to do algebra. So it's got a positive bend to it. So community is obviously a part of what all of you do. Gloria, you've inspired global excitement among women, among others. And John, you discuss in your new book, Life is Good. And certainly you've tapped into the online community, Jessica. So. What would you say is important about the power of community? And this is a community of women who would like to share together and learn from each other. But why is that so important? And we'll start with you, Jessica. I'm sorry, Gloria.
Because we are communal animals. If we are alone, we soon feel crazy, despairing. You know, I mean, we haven't been sitting around a campfire for 100,000 years for nothing. So. We need to be together, we need to share our stories. And actually now, physiologically, neurologically, you can demonstrate this, because we do not empathize on a screen, as wonderful as the screen may be, or even a book, as much as I love books. We empathize only when we are together with all five senses. The oxytocin, you know, the so-called tend and befriend hormone that both women and men say, experience of Russia when holding children and so on. I mean, it's what allows us not just to know, but to understand. And that only happens when people are present in all five senses. And it's part of the reason that on the web, people can be more hostile than they would be in person. So it isn't to say the web isn't a good thing, but it isn't complete by itself. We have to be together in groups.
Physically. And what do you think of community and its importance?
I mean, community is everything. I am approaching all of this as a businesswoman and all of this from the perspective of being a new parent, because that was my moment of awakening. And the truth of it takes a village to raise a child, it couldn't be more apparent than the first day you have this child and you're like, oh dear, what do I do? And you find that your village is online. There are communities of women online that are going through the exact same thing that you're going through, and they are living in another state and another reality, but you can come together and you can bond over this day-to-day thing that's happening. I rely on the communities online to help me and support me, and it helped me navigate through those first few years of parenthood and help me feel not totally alone.
But are there communities of men online, of fathers?
I don't know.
Are there communities of fathers online?
There should be.
There are. I can't say I'm on there often, but I know they exist. And
I think it's called ESPN.com.
That would be my guess.
Wait a minute. I mean, you know, women become whole people by venturing outside the home. Men become whole people by venturing inside the home. I mean, that's the way men develop their full circle of human qualities.
Right.
So when we say parent, I think we have to take it seriously.
When you have male friends as a guy that you can go deep with, you know, you can have laughs with, but you can also get into the harder stuff about work or raising a family, that's really helpful. So that is needed in our world. I want to point out, I think the theme of this conference is not the power of me, it's the power of us, and compassion is hardwired in us. And the biggest thing we've learned is to stay open, and you don't have to have all the answers. And I shared the Boston Marathon example, but you know, we did a fundraiser after 9/11. It wasn't our idea. It was someone in our community saying, why don't you do a fundraiser? And sure enough, our whole team felt better because we were being active and helping, trying to do something to make it better. And the more you stay open to your community, it sounds like you do the same thing, the smarter you're going to get, the more you're going to grow. So community is absolutely essential in our businesses and in our lives.
And that leads to a point that, Gloria, you made in your newest book when you were quoting a story from Dr. Sharp saying, I've done the best I could with my life. How can we inspire more people, again, not to aim for perfect, but to aim for heart and to do the best they can in their lives? And looking back, that would be the key. And we'll start with Jessica on this.
Gosh. I think everybody wants to feel like they're part of something bigger than themselves, and there's nothing more gratifying than paying it forward or giving back. In a weird way, it's when you feel the most complete, is when you feel like you are making a bigger impact than what you can do in your own personal day-to-day life. And if you can be part of a movement, it's powerful. And you know, we do live in a country where if we galvanize and if we put our focus on something, we could actually move things forward and we can actually make a difference. And that's very powerful, because there are lots of countries and lots of women out there who just don't have a voice. So we need to raise our voices even louder, and men, and support each other in things that are gonna move us forward as a people. Because we sure need it.
And John, what do you think?
I hope Jessica won't be offended by this, but we're sitting next to someone who's accomplished so much, maybe more than us, and I would say amplifying the voice of people that have accomplished a lot, because if you look at them and you listen, you realize the fulfillment is not coming from awards they received or things they've acquired, it's from people they've helped. And if young people can understand that early, they may decide, and we encourage it all the time, to weave a social purpose, a deeper purpose into whatever you choose to do with your life, because that's ultimately what's going to be most fulfilling for them. And that means not waiting till you made it to give back. That means weaving it in so that, you know, selfishly, it's going to help you avoid burnout. It's going to help you get fired up to go to work in the morning if you have an underlying purpose that helps other people.
And Gloria, tell us about that quote and what it means to you.
I think just what you were saying is, you know, people say the ends justify the means, which is an absolute lie, because the means dictate the ends. Mm. So we just need to do the closest to what we want every day. If we want in the future to have poetry and fun and dancing, we have to have it in our lives now. You can't just suppress it and think it's going to pop up over there. If we want kindness in our lives, we have to practice it now. And I think it's really important to understand that there is no should. It's not something up there that tells us what to do. The point is to do everything we can and to instill in every day, you know, the qualities that we hope for. And that way you don't burn out, as you point out. You ensure that you will have them, even if you get hit by a truck the next day. You will have had a good day the day before, mm-hmm. which is crucial. Right. And you will be recognizing something else, which is that change comes from the ground up, not from the top down. It grows like a tree. It's us. And we just have to behave as if everything we do matters, because it might.
Mm. Terrific. Ladies and gentlemen, Gloria Steinem, Jessica Alba, John Jacobs, incredible.